What's up, everyone? We are here on a sunny, Bermudaful day, and we have a very special occasion. We have the opportunity of talking with Peter Corbett, and we have a room full of young entrepreneurs, the brightest from around the island. So we're going to do a live Q&A, and we're also going to allow people that are tuning in to ask any questions that they have. So this is going to be geared towards small businesses, entrepreneurs, and we're going to focus on innovation, disruption, as you like to, you know, talk about that. And we'll just freestyle it. We'll just go with the wind.
Let's do it.
It's not your first time in Bermuda?
No, second time. I got engaged here about 2 years ago.
Okay. And you're coming back for the wedding this time? Or we just got you?
We got married last year, okay. But came back to...
Honeymoon?
Did that in Hawaii. Always selling Bermuda.
You're just here for a little R&R and to...
A little rest and relaxation and to meet local entrepreneurs and share what I know about building a business, see if I can be helpful in some way.
All right, and shout out to the business, the Bermuda Economic Development Corporation, for facilitating this whole event. And ladies and gentlemen, we're talking to Peter Corbett, once again, founder and CEO of iStrategy Labs, which is a digital agency. You're based in New York right now.
Mm-hmm. New York and D.C.
And D.C.
Yeah.
And you develop solutions to clients' challenges, bringing them to life in the online and offline world. And you've worked with quite a few of the Fortune 500 companies, just a couple.
I think 25 of the Fortune 500 now.
That's it?
Yeah, we're working our way through. Some of them are boring, so I don't really want to work with
those. What are some of the interesting ones?
The interesting ones, Volkswagen, Sam Adams, Kroger, Microsoft, Intel, Google, Facebook, General Electric, NBC Universal, Disney, ABC, NPR, PBS, a bunch of others.
Okay.
Yeah. And so it's been exciting.
You've with Facebook, you've met Mark?
I have. Mark went to my high school. Mm-hmm. I met him at South by Southwest. I think Facebook only had 25 million users at the time, which is a lot of users, mind you, but when they're 2 billion now, I would say they were a mere startup.
Right.
I think Mark's done a little bit better than I have in my entrepreneurial journey, but you shouldn't really compare yourself to others too much.
Right. Okay, and with your company, you started from a very small business. We have, again, a lot of small businesses inside this room. Can you just sort of set the table and give us your vision in creating this business
out of necessity. I got laid off when I was 27.
Okay.
I got laid off on a Friday. And so naturally, I got really drunk that night with my friends.
Sam Adams?
Yeah, I had some Sam Adams. Woke up on that Saturday, didn't feel that great. But once my head cleared, I realized I didn't want the narrative to be that I had gotten laid off. That Monday, I wanted the world to wake up and hear that I had started a company rather than having gotten laid off. So that first year, it was just me. Bootstrapped it out of my apartment. I had about 3 months of living expenses in the bank, and I just wanted to add another month. And if I didn't, I thought, you know, I'll starve and die. The reality is, I wouldn't have starved, I wouldn't have died, I would have had to have moved in with my parents, and that's basically like dying. I love my parents, but at 27, that's kind of the worst thing that could happen. And so I just kept pushing. The second year I had one employee, the third year I had four, the fourth year I had eight, about 90 now. Sold the company last year to WPP, which is the world's largest publicly traded advertising agency holding company.
Okay.
And I'm still the CEO, still running the show, still enjoying myself.
That's how you do it. You just grow it organically, flip it when it gets really big, and still be at the helm.
I haven't used flip it as the phrase. I prefer to say that we wanted to have a relationship with a bigger company so that we could penetrate new markets more easily. Being independent, small and independent in the sort of digital agency world is a exciting and rewarding thing. It's also very dangerous, right? You run the risk of losing a major client, you have to fire half your team. Do you ever recover from that? So I wanted to make sure I was de-risking the business as it got bigger, because you've got people's livelihoods in your hands. You know, people have husbands and wives and children, and you need to make sure that there's continuity to the business, and being independent can be really difficult sometimes.
Did you envision when you started it that you would have 90 employees? Have worked with 25 or plus of the Fortune 500 companies?
It was certainly my aspiration, but I didn't think it would happen, right? I hoped that it would happen. And then some, you know, looking back, I remember there were moments where it was like, wow, when did this happen? Like, wow, I have an executive team, very talented individuals that run the business day to day. That enables me to come to Bermuda and share what I know with folks. I don't have to be tied to my email every moment. And I was doing that for the past 4 years, man. I've been to 30 or 40 countries for reasons like this, and the business was still growing. Mm-hmm. So I felt like, wow, I built a company that was much more than me.
Right.
And I think that's the goal. At least it was a goal for me. Some people want to build a business that makes them the ego king or queen of the thing. And I just never wanted that. I wasn't trying to enshrine myself as a deity. It was like, can I build something that people enjoy working in and produces some sort of value in the world?
Very interesting. And starting a company from scratch, small business, assuming you have a great product or service, because that's, I suppose, you know, the main thing. Yeah, without that, it's kind of hard to, you know, put... you know, the icing on top of a cake that doesn't exist. But what's the best approach in leveraging, you know, social media, digital media, internet, connected devices? We live in a world where everything is connected to...
There's a few things that will always work. People are sort of ravenous consumers of content. Mm-hmm. We're curious. We want to learn. Or most people want to learn.
Yeah.
And so if you produce content that, you know, somehow related to your brand, hopefully very related to your brand... they will come,
right?
There were moments when I would write a blog post on iStrategy Labs' blog, and there were moments when hundreds of thousands of people would visit our site over the next few months because this was information they couldn't find anywhere else. And there was one example, I remember one client reached out and said, oh, we read this blog post you wrote, we have a project, do you want to take a look at it? It ended up being worth $20 million to us over 4 years.
Wow.
So the fact that you can sit down, write something for an hour, and it can turn into massive amounts of revenue is an incredible thing. It wasn't possible, you know, 10 or 20 years ago. So we live in this sort of golden age, I think, of content marketing. So I think any small business, doesn't matter how small or even how big, like content marketing is an incredibly powerful way of attracting customers.
Mm-hmm.
Outside of that, depending on the business, you know, this idea of building a personal brand can be important. It's a double-edged sword.
Right.
You really need to be building the brand of the product or service that you're selling. If I had built the Peter Corbett brand bigger than my company, I worry that if ever I wanted to leave, the business would have a real problem.
Right.
And I haven't. The company's brand is much, much bigger than mine, which is great. It does help if you have some sort of reputation and clout and influence and presence, because if I tweet or something like that, you know, people might see that, they might reach out, and I've had that personally happen a lot. So I think it's helpful to build both a company brand and a personal brand simultaneously, but the company brand should hopefully be much bigger.
Right. And this makes me think of Steve Jobs, you know, he passed, and what's going to happen
after.
Yeah,
sure.
You know, huge personality that everyone knew. And right now, you know, we live in an age where, I'm assuming we're pretty close to the same age.
I'm 37.
I'm 37 as well.
It's
a big year.
Yeah, 1980.
So we both come up in an age where, you know, for 50 years it was TV, it was radio, there were these traditional ways of advertising, getting the message to your consumer. And now in the span of 10 years, you know, you've seen a company like Facebook go from 25 million users to 2 billion users.
Mm-hmm.
You've seen, you know, Amazon displaced a whole industry of, you know, commerce.
Every
day. Seeing just so much disruption. And when you think about a small business, the first thing that you learn in college is SWOT analysis. Strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, threats. And you think of that, and then 6 months later, the whole thing could flip and turn on top of you. How do you navigate that approach to doing business, knowing that we live in a world that's just...
Sure. I think a few ways. The first thing is really to be very aware of what the threats are. I think that we live in a day and age where Amazon really could cannibalize almost anything. It's sort of wild. So the first question I ask is, what would Amazon do? And if it's nothing, then you're great. That's a great space. Like, you're going to be fine.
Whole Foods.
Right? So, but if the answer is like, oh, wow, they're probably just going to private label this specific product offering, and they might not do it today, but they'll do it 2 or 3 years from now, I don't know if I want to get into that business. Facebook and Google and Apple, you know, they, between all of those companies, they actually have sucked up a lot of the opportunity. So when I meet people like, oh, I want to build an awesome AR or VR company, I'm like, why? And this was 2 months ago, Facebook launched their AR platform. Mm-hmm. And so then I'm like, this is why. Because now AR is entirely owned by Facebook and actually Apple, because they launched their AR kit as well. So as entrepreneurs, you have to constantly be paranoid. If you're not paranoid, you're going to be eaten by a lion at some point. Mm-hmm. So you have to keep focusing on what are those big competitors going to do? What are they not going to do? I want to be in a space that they're not going to do it. And then it comes down to always focusing on the product or the service. And that product or service has to be incredible. There's a great book, I hope many of you read it, called Purple Cow, which talks about, like, it's basically like if you saw a purple cow in a field, you'd pay attention to it. You'd be like, what is that? That's interesting. And it's all about how to, you know, position a product as something that is inherently valuable rather than something that needs to be marketed. Mm-hmm. So I always, like, even though I'm in the business of marketing, it's just, what is something that's so good that you literally just don't need to market it because people want to buy it, they find out about it through word of mouth. Mm-hmm. And if you can find that and avoid the, you know, the behemoth oligopoly of technology out there, you might be fine. Right. I'll say might. Yes. It's like with an asterisk. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay, very cool. And you've worked again with some of the Fortune 500 companies. Mm-hmm. And we're going to take some questions. If you have any questions in the audience, I'm going to look out for that. And also, phone strike. Alright, we're back. Technology. Shout out to Facebook. We keep having this conspiracy that they're trying to geofence
us. If we talk about
that you're here.
Yes.
And so we're
happens.
Back.
Sorry.
Alright. So we were talking about some of the companies that you have worked with. Mm-hmm. Some of them are huge companies. Mm-hmm. So the question is, what are some of the examples of major challenges? Hurdles that you've gone into, and examples of cool things that you sort of envision for these companies. Yeah. Like, what's the coolest thing that
what's
you've
done? What's the coolest thing we've done?
Like your rock star moment.
We've done so many cool things. All right, so two rock star moments. Last year, we won 20 Cannes Lions. I don't know if anyone knows what that is. Those are like the Academy Awards for marketing.
Congratulations.
Thank you. And one of those campaigns won 19 of them. One of them won one. So the one that won 19, we took a school bus, we took it into a warehouse, we ripped it apart, we installed these translucent LCD screens so that we could build a roving Mars rover, so that when kids got in the bus and you make a right turn, it feels like and looks like you're on Mars making that left right turn. It's called the Field Trip to Mars. So if you Google that, you'll find the case study that we put up. We had bets going. We wanted to see, we thought, will the kids puke or will they cry?
All right, and we're back. Second conspiracy, Bermuda Internet.
Back. So we had a good question off camera.
And once again, we're talking to Peter Corbett.
He's still
the CEO of iStrategy Labs.
Yes.
So we had a question that came.
Yeah. The question was, were there points in time of growing this business that there were inflection points, or I felt it was becoming successful, or felt it was different in some way, shape, or form.
Aha moments?
No, not aha moments. Just this feeling, this visceral feeling as an entrepreneur that, like, this is working or this is not working, or it's different. And it's sort of interesting. I look back on it, it's almost like multiples of two. But actually, I'll start with, like, going zero to one. Zero employees to your first employee, that's the biggest deal. It's the hardest thing to do. I think the statistic I saw in the U.S. is it's something like 0.4% of new companies ever have one employee. So for any of you out there that have grown a company with at least one employee, like, you're one, 4 out of 1,000. It's amazing. I feel like when we got to 5 people, it felt like a real team. That feels so good. That's such a great number of people. 15, I think, was when I was like, oh my God, actually, I can't do 15 performance reviews. I can't manage 15 people. This is crazy. I was well underwater. And so I started to put together an executive team. By the time we were about 30, I had a very well-formed executive team. For me, that's chief operating officer, chief marketing officer, VP of engineering, VP of client services, and a creative director. And so they could run their own teams, and they probably had 4 or 5 people under them in each area. think we were about 50 people is when I realized, and this was like going to be the third office, right? So we're just growing out of the walls and busting through and going to new spaces. I was like, wow, we need much more rigorous financials. We need to be able to forecast better. So the financial piece starts to become much more important. And that's the point where I felt like we began really competing with the biggest and best agencies in the world and beating them, sometimes getting beaten. And so I said, wow, the thing that I have grown, we're no longer just this little company in Washington, D.C. We're on a global stage with global competition, so I need to be thinking about it that way. And that's one of the reasons why I sold the company last year when we reached about, I think it was about 90 employees, about $15 million in revenue. So yeah, there are a bunch of sort of step stages of plateaus where things get different, feel different. Mm-hmm. When did I feel like it was really successful or succeeding? God, it was probably around 25 or 30 people, you know? And the reason why was just specifically in the digital agency space. I meet a lot of people that are able to grow companies from, you know, 0 to 10 people maybe. Very few get beyond 20 because maybe they're a founder who's a, you know, a creative or a founder who's a technologist. But they don't love the business part. I was lucky enough to be someone that loved the business part, really understood the technology part, really understood the creative mm-hmm. part. So I got beyond that threshold,
right.
I think because of that combination.
Very cool. And you continue to, I mean, are you ever going to have thoughts of creating another company, or are you pretty much, this is your
one
baby?
One day. Okay. Well, it's not a baby anymore. It's at least, well, literally 10 years old, but it's a young adult.
Kids,
it's a young adult
baby
of a company. You know, it's now owned by a publicly traded company, so it's not mine either. So it's like a young adult who's a part of a global corporation.
Wow. It must be very rewarding.
Isn't that
to see
the
that
aspiration that we have in life as capitalists? Yeah.
So yesterday, if you heard any noise here in Bermuda, it was because we were having an election.
I heard a little bit of noise. I heard about that.
And one thing that the new government that has been elected, one of the plans that they have mm-hmm. is to build a tech incubator here mm-hmm. in Bermuda. Have you ever worked in a tech incubator? And if so, what does that look like? And what are some of the things that you saw working in that type of environment?
I've been a mentor in probably 30 of them in probably 20 countries. Mm-hmm. So I've seen the full gamut. And I've seen them go from nothing to something. I think if it's government-led, it probably won't be that great. I think if it's entrepreneurial-led, led by entrepreneurs, led by investors, it'll probably be at least have a chance of being good.
Right.
Who knows? It'll be great. I mean, it'll be great if the local Bermudans are incredibly talented, mm-hmm. and this is the catalyst for sparking the creation of new businesses that will deliver value in the world. And who knows? I mean, I don't know how big the engineering and design community is here. Even if it's 1,000 people, and maybe that's a lot, maybe that's a little, I don't know, for Bermuda. If they've got like the passion and drive to do something great, you'll probably see some really interesting companies come out of it. If people just kind of want to build another app because they think it's cool, all right, fine. It'll just be another app. It won't be a business.
Yeah.
So, don't let it be a political effort because it'll probably fail. Did I not say that more clearly?
Let us try it. You want us to have the keys. That's good.
Yeah, that's it.
You don't mind that?
Listen, honestly, I've seen the model in so many places. Mm-hmm. They should write a grant, right? X amount of dollars. Some real estate developer here who's got empty space, who understands that these are going to be companies that will eventually grow and pay them rent, should donate space. Mm-hmm. And then there should be someone who knows how to do this that comes in and is happy to be the executive director of it for 2 years or so. Or if there's a Bermudan that's done this somewhere else, great, come back.
Cool.
And then you cycle through, all of the corporate development and developer evangelism teams from Google and Amazon and Facebook and SendGrid and Twilio and Salesforce and Oracle and Cisco, and have them be corporate sponsors and teach local entrepreneurs about all the offerings that they can integrate with. And over the course of a year's time, people should have really great ideas for new stuff to build and have new relationships they didn't have before.
All right.
It's just that easy.
If you don't do it, government, if you don't do it, we're going to tell you that Peter Till is here. Thank you for the blueprint on that. And, you know, you have a small business, great products and services. In your opinion, you know, in the latter part of 2017 now, what are some of the emerging technologies that you have your eye on? You mentioned augmented reality, AR. That's a huge thing that seems to be getting a lot of buy-in from the big companies.
Yeah, AR is probably the most exciting emerging technology to me personally. And just in the past 3 months, there's just been an explosion in that space because Apple launched ARKit just after Facebook launched AR Studio. Mm-hmm. And so now every phone out there in the world has the ability just to be an augmented reality device, whereas before you needed some kind of special app to download or otherwise. And obviously Snapchat has this capability as well. The issue with this space is that it is already owned by Apple and Facebook. So I would never try to create AR technology.
Right.
Like, that doesn't make sense to me.
Rather embrace it.
Yeah, the opportunity, actually, I was speaking with BizCamp earlier today, and these are a bunch of teenagers going through like a business boot camp. And one of them, he's not a teenager anymore, I think he's 20, he's a 3D artist and understands 3D modeling and animation. And he said, look, I used to sell my 3D models online, but that business is kind of going away. What should I be doing? I was like, dude, AR is exploding. My team just last week spent $2,000 like buying little 3D models in order to put it into Facebook AR's app to do something interesting. And so he didn't realize that. Mm-hmm. So there's opportunity around the edges of the platform to do interesting things. I don't think that you'll build billion-dollar businesses on top of Facebook AR. But you can build several million-dollar businesses.
What do you see, like, you know, if you're... What are some of the real-world applications
stuff
that you can...
Back.
All right.
And we're back. I'm here with...
Don't talk about Facebook.
So
every time you say the F word.
Besides augmented reality, the other thing I'm most excited about is internet connected devices, which many of you know in the form of something like Nest or Amazon's Echo or Google Home or anything like that. We've been building internet connected devices now for probably 5 years for our clients. Simple things, like we built a refrigerator for GE that if 10 friends tweet or check in on Foursquare, it unlocks so you can get the free beer or soda inside. Actually, you could build it so that it wouldn't unlock unless you checked in at the gym within the last day or so.
Nice.
All right, so like letting online actions turn into offline actions is a fascinating space to me. There's all sorts of devices that will be invented over the coming years that will change the way you interact with the physical world. If you just look around you right now and ask yourself, like, what's connected? The only answer basically is your phones, right? It should be your lights. I mean, connected lights are something you can buy off the shelf today. If you just start to walk around, you're like, what else is going to get embedded with some kind of computer technology in the next decade? You could come up with brand new systems for tracking your dog, or brand new ways of monitoring retail foot traffic, or anything like that. So it's, I think, a kind of a wide open space when you talk about internet-connected devices.
All right, and things we don't have in Bermuda. You'd be surprised.
Mm-hmm. You're
top of the list, Apple and Samsung Pay.
Ah.
Yeah.
Hmm. Who cares?
No.
Really, like, who cares? No. I mean, Apple Pay is really convenient, but I don't imagine that it's going to take over the world. I'm sure you have Venmo, right?
Yeah. So wouldn't it help us more?
You don't even have Venmo. You probably have an incredibly powerful financial lobbying organization on this island. Mobile payments from a text-based structure is much more popular than Apple Pay or Samsung Pay. That, if you've been to Africa, and I've been to probably, I think, 7 African countries now, one of the most popular methods of paying for things, like far beyond what you see in the States or in Europe. So I'm not so much worried about, the mobile phone platforms owning that space. I think there's always going to be a diverse set of things to use.
So it's, I think it's just a hurdle for, you know, small businesses to have access to different ways of receiving that quick payment.
So right now it's just a swipe or cash?
Swipe, and it's pretty expensive. So
3.5%?
And I won't go into it any further because I work for a bank. But it would be great, you know, once we get those sort of technologies in Bermuda to see what sort of...
But Apple Pay is still going to cost you. I mean, you're going to lose a few percent here and there with that technology.
But if I get on a bus and just...
Yeah, they're still going to take a transaction fee, right? I mean, the lowest transaction fee is going to be Bitcoin or Ether, but consumers are not going to pay with cryptocurrency anytime soon.
We don't have Uber.
Probably better off. It's kind of a horrible company.
Yeah.
But, you know. I don't know if you've read anything about their corporate culture.
Still alive.
Still alive. We are still alive. No, I do think that car sharing here would be incredibly useful.
Yeah.
Why don't you have a car sharing company?
So you have taxis that would probably, they would like that.
Yeah, they're not happy anyway. They don't like that in the States.
There was a hitch, yeah.
You have hitch?
Hitch
is a payment processor for cabs, no?
Yeah, basically. I think it's
it has GPS functionality too.
Yeah. But I think it's basically like Uber, but instead of calling a regular car, you're calling cabs that subscribe to this service.
So we have an online question coming in. And feel free if you're watching this.
Yeah, a real question.
Definitely. Sure.
Yeah. I have a real question. One of my biggest gripes, well, it's not mine, but everybody's really, is the amount that we pay for internet here versus the speeds and services that we get.
Sure.
And I think because that's happened, because we're in that situation, Bermudians are very slow to catch on to all this technology that we're talking about, IoT devices and such.
Yeah.
And I teach in a school, so public school. So as a result, public schools have pretty bad infrastructure as well. So I think my question is, how can we get Bermuda in a situation where we're not paying so much for internet?
Yeah.
So that basically,
what are you paying and what's the speed?
Well, we dropped off 3 times. We didn't pay $9 a month for the internet. We probably paid about 100.
Okay, 100
and
bucks a month.
That's giving you about 15
megs,
right?
About 15 megs at my house, and I'm paying about $170.
Yeah.
And
then
deep
next door
for like 120.
Digest that.
Listen, you're off by a factor of 10 for the U.S., which is also bad compared to the globe.
Yeah.
Right, so if you're in South Korea, you're probably getting about a gig down for about $100. In New York, you're getting about 100, 150 megs down for about $100. Okay, so a few things. One, this whole space is going to get dramatically disrupted in the next decade, and it's going to come from satellites, and it's going to come from probably Google, or it's going to come from Facebook. So you can buy the stock now and pray to God that they give you incredible high-speed broadband from the universe.
What is that one that Google's developing?
I think they call it Google Sky. It might be, or Loon, maybe.
It's like a drone that flies over.
Yeah, so you're going to get internet access from satellites at some point. It's going to take a while. They're testing it now. They have things that work. But to blanket the entire globe with broadband from the stratosphere takes a little bit of doing. But that will change. The other way to do it, which will probably take the same amount of time, is to lobby your government so hard to put this as the key initiative that they need to focus on to upgrade the backhaul of the country. That's not cheap. That's probably a couple $1 billion or more. But I'm sure there's some investment banks on the island that would love to underwrite the debt in some way, shape, or form for a 10% payment per year, and they'll own your infrastructure.
I think one of our biggest issues is the economies of scale.
Yeah, small subscriber base.
Yeah.
So why do it? That's why satellite-based is probably the way to go, because you just stick the satellite up, they're not going to add another one for another country.
So my grandkids are probably going to have pretty good answers.
They should.
But it is a huge
fantastic.
Now, I would hope that this is a decade, not too much longer off. I know that's frustrating, but...
Is that a surprise? Back to that price point?
That is a surprise. It's much more expensive than I expected. I expected a sub 50 meg download speed. I've experienced it.
I was getting 50 meg.
Okay. So sub 20
meg. Talk about Facebook all day.
Yeah. Does anyone have fast internet on the other? Like,
they... I'm pretty sure they do. I think there's a couple people that are like beta testers, and they'll get like 50 meg or something like that for a decent price, but it's not like...
Your happiness is consistent.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, I'm paying for 50. I'm not getting 15.
Yeah.
I might be getting 12.
Wow.
Like, we have our credit card machines in store. Just won't work for hours at a time.
Yeah.
You just take a risk that the internet will come back on in those crazy prices. But, at one point, it was just holding up business because you didn't...
That's it. I mean, I've seen that in so many places in the world, by the way. It's not just Bermuda. And it's certainly not just islands.
The price, though? What connectivity?
Not as much the price. Intermittent connectivity, slow speeds. Jamaica has a very similar issue.
For intermittent connectivity, it'd be less of a gripe.
Yeah.
It's still great.
But I mean, like, for $170, man. Like, only one of us could watch Paul at a time.
I wonder if you could form a consumer lobbying organization and get 50,000 Bermudans signed up to be pissed off at Digicel or whomever and demand to lower the price or invest in the infrastructure.
He said it. I thought I liked the song. And it is a huge
Your phone's never going to work again.
To those of you, I mean, Birmingham, we try to cover stuff all of the time. And our biggest concern when we walk into any space is, oh, God, 50 people are going to have their cell phones within this space, and it's just not going to work. So we're working on it.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to lobby for that.
Mm-hmm.
And we have a question coming in.
Somebody in my audience wants to know, if not a colleague, wants to know what programming language or languages would this adult for beginner to learn?
Yeah, that's a great question. I would recommend Python, Python or JavaScript. JavaScript, if you're sort of maybe more visual in nature and you want to get into front-end engineering, did we lose you?
No,
battery. Python, if you possibly want to build more sophisticated applications and maybe do something with quote-unquote big data. Our shop is a Python shop, probably about 20 engineers or so. And there's a big battle on the internet, Python versus Ruby on Rails. And frankly, they're both awesome languages for building stuff. But I personally think Python is a good language to work with.
Cool.
Good question.
I tell people this all the time, but I think it'd be good to get your input. So my degree is graphic design, and I have people that will come to me and say, "Oh, I want to get into graphic design," and I try to encourage them. Like, that's cool.
Yeah.
But I try to encourage them to go more towards the web development side.
Yeah.
Because I think it's just more marketable that way. So.
I 100% agree. The reality is, though, that you have to become, if you want to be a web designer or whatever, you need to be a good visual designer.
Yeah.
So that can start with graphic design, which is, I don't want to call it easy, but it's just less complicated because it's not moving around.
Right.
You don't interact with it. You can just make a flat thing and you can print a thing, or it could just, you know, be an image. So I think you need to start with the fundamentals of visual design. And then if you're talented, you have a good eye, you just have a sensibility for the work, becoming a web designer is, I think, a much more lucrative path. There's much more demand for those services, I think, globally. I think the rates for hiring people through things like Upwork.com or Freelance.com or otherwise probably 2x what it is for just a graphic designer. It's harder. You should be learning how to program simultaneously. Some people don't feel like they can do that, which is crazy because anyone can learn how to program. It just is sort of maybe lazy then. It's like, oh, I want to be a web designer, but I can't learn how to program. It's like, okay, well, what if you don't eat? I'm pretty sure you can learn how to program. So yeah, I would learn how to do graphic design as fundamentals, start with Photoshop and Illustrator, and then as fast as possible, I would get into HTML, CSS, and JavaScript so you can turn your designs into things that can actually be interacted with.
All right, and in this day and age, we'll ask a couple more questions. I think we're almost out of time. Mm-hmm. Sure.
Question. From the country that you worked in, when you think of places like Bermuda where we don't have the financial infrastructure to process payments, we don't have the IT infrastructure, and sometimes you see the internet keep dropping.
Yeah.
So people are used to doing face-to-face transactions. If you have a completely online business, online-based business, how do you convert users that are used to traditional type business transactions to make the leap and trust that they can go online, put in their card information, and start to transact?
Do you feel, so the question is like, if there's difficulty with infrastructure, how do you get people comfortable transacting? Do you feel like Bermudans won't engage in e-commerce because they're worried about their payments not going through?
I think that there just aren't many e-commerce businesses based in Bermuda. When I say e-commerce, I mean exclusively. Almost every business here has a physical storefront.
Yeah.
But if you have a business that's a complete service,
just
but
web.
It's only based online, I don't think there. I can't name many of any.
People are very comfortable like buying from Victoria's Secrets or
whatever.
They wouldn't go and buy from Gibbons online or any of the local. Or we have an online platform, but most of our customers are from the US. They're not locals.
Yeah, and they would just rather show up in person?
Bermudians just prefer face-to-face transactions. So
I think this is a marketing problem. It's just a matter of creating the right package. What you really want to do is sell more online, then the online purchase is less than the offline purchase. Like, it's simple as that. And I'm not suggesting cutting margins out. Do the math and go, does it cost us more for the goods that are sold in physical retail based on the rent that we pay and the lights that we keep on, etc.? Is that cost basis different from when we ship via web? And if it is, you might say, look, shorts on the web are 10% less than shorts in the store. But my concern would be, what is the actual average transaction for people that come into the store versus average transaction on the web? Because someone might normally buy a pair of shorts and also the socks when they're coming in the store, but they never bought the socks when they go online. So now you're losing revenue. So you've just got to understand the segmentation of like the revenue and the cost structures of online versus off, and then tune that through smart marketing. I think it's a discount structure if you really want to drive digital.
I would think you're more of a service more than a product.
Yeah.
I have a good example. There's a hardware store here that brings in goods, containers and everything, and they launch an online service.
Yeah.
Where basically, a person can go online to Amazon, say one, and they'll bring it in. They bring it and ship.
So they manage the reception of large objects.
Yeah. So
like a snowblower, which is very popular here.
So what they did is they made this online platform.
And no one used it.
But they hosted it inside their store. So enabled.
It's a kiosk.
So you have to go in and then someone's going to stand over your shoulder and help you. And people
it's sort
are
of interesting.
Why can't I do that from my home?
Well, they should be able to do it from their home, but it's not a bad way to introduce an e-commerce solution, right? So if you already have foot traffic and you've got maybe an older clientele that used to come to the hardware store to buy a hammer, fine, put up the kiosk. We're like, hey, Bob, we've got a great website now that we can get snowblowers here in Bermuda because we know you want a snowblower.
Right.
Check it out. And you're like, oh, all right, I'll just order that online next time. Right? So you also have to think about like onboarding consumers from their pre-existing buying behavior to a new buying behavior. And we forget, we just sort of assume because we're digitally connected entrepreneurs, they're like, of course, I'll just put up the website and everyone's going to use that now. It's like, no, they're still going to do what they normally do. Because behavior change is like it has a lot of friction. There's a lot of mental overhead that goes into that. I do it myself. I see, I'm like, I could do this a different way, but I'll just do it the way I've been doing it. Right?
Do you have any key kind of media marketing strategies for helping us grow international recognition of the local businesses and websites? So I want to take my existing website, but I want to reach people all over the US, you know, Facebook ads,
yeah.
Instagram ads.
Yeah.
Are there any changes? Are there any new platforms
that
you're aware of?
So the question is about, I'm repeating the question because I assume
yeah,
it's too
great,
far away.
Yeah.
The question is about, like, what do I know about any kind of emerging or new marketing or media properties to help a local business get national or international reach? A few things. One, I do think that Facebook and Google advertising remains to be a rather efficient mechanism. I know that costs have gone up over time. So if you're not doing a very diligent segmentation of your marketing lists and segments in Facebook and Google itself, you should be. So you should be understanding, like, is a dollar spent $2 in revenue? If you feel like, oh, it's a risk, like, I don't know if I should waste $5,000 on marketing those channels, I don't think it can ever be wasted. I think it's learning. You just have to figure out what your tolerance for learning is. So those are the big guys. Those have been the big guys for some time. I think they remain to be the big guys. And I would say Facebook and Google, and specifically YouTube as well, if your product is highly visual, it would work really well. For someone who has a local business that is creating a product that anyone can buy anywhere or should, I do think that PR is crucial. And I think you have to tell the founder's story. I think the founder's story is something that, I'll speak from an American perspective, everybody wants to hear about founders. It's the American dream, it's the country, it's a startup country, or it was 200 something years ago. So we want to hear those stories of the woman who came back to Bermuda and resurrected the Bermuda short, and why, and how is it made, and how is she succeeding? We want those stories. So. Really good storytelling around the origin story, I think, is crucial. I think there's an unlimited number of opportunities to pitch publications in that regard. You can do that yourself. You don't have to hire a PR agency. Actually, in my experience and in my understanding, journalists love hearing from entrepreneurs directly. They feel like they're getting pitched by a PR agency. It's just like yet another press release, and they know that PR person gets paid to do this. It doesn't feel as good, but when you reach out and say, like, I want to send you a pair of socks, hike them up to your knees, they're going to go, what the? Okay, that's cool. What's this about? What's that? So that would be my pitch. my subject line.
Hey, it's cheaper than my shorts.
So. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. That's why I said the socks, you don't want to give away the shorts. Outside of that, you know, I don't think that Snapchat is very relevant of a platform in general, specifically for, I would say, for Bermuda shorts, and also for the fact that the amount of analytics and data you get back from them is basically nil. So, like, I don't know that I would spend my marketing and learning dollars there. Unless you're a Fortune 500 where writing $400,000 checks to Snapchat is like no big deal, which is what it is. So, yeah.
I don't know much fun about that.
One more question and I'll
ask. So, I watch a lot of YouTube.
Mm-hmm.
And I still feel like YouTube is an awesome platform if you're trying to promote a product that you have, or if you're trying to develop something, you can show, like, this is how you can use it, this
sure.
is how you can use it, this is how
yep.
you can use it. I know Facebook video is coming up as well. How could you compare the two?
Yeah.
As far as, like, I'm not a type of person that says use this, don't use that.
Yeah, yeah.
But I do understand that they have very different.
Yeah. It depends on the objective. So with YouTube, you can be in the revenue sharing program, and so that can become a very significant revenue stream for people.
Right.
So if your objective was, I want to be, you know, a little YouTube celebrity of some form or another, and I want to get a few grand a month in revenue based on, you know, the views of my channel, YouTube is the play. Facebook doesn't do that. So you can't do that on Facebook, and so it'd be sort of a waste of your time to build a Facebook channel. I would be very focused on YouTube. What Facebook would be then is merely additional reach for the content that you're producing that might possibly get people to know about you, and therefore maybe they're watching on your YouTube channel, which is where you actually make money. I would actually think it's more cannibalizing the viewership rather than sort of being additive. So I would be like YouTube focused if I was trying to generate revenue from the ad share program. If I wasn't trying to drive revenue through viewership in YouTube, but I was driving revenue because the thing I'm talking about people are buying on my website or otherwise, then I'm going after both of them full force. And I would be going after, depending on the product, I'd probably be more focused on Instagram versus Facebook proper. Or depending on the product, I'd be focused on all three of them just as much. And so it's really a matter of making sure that when you're producing content, that it looks great in each of those three, because each of them has their own little idiosyncrasy that makes for editors to have a job in the world. So, yeah, you're going to want to make sure that if autoplay sound is not on Facebook, then you've got your text overlays, and if it's Instagram, you're going to want to make sure that your shot, you know, is in your kind of square format, and that your edges aren't, nothing important is happening on the edges, so that you can easily output to a square image. And I'm sure that there's, you know, programs now that you just upload the file and it'll auto-format it into three different platforms easily. And if not, someone should make that. Make a lot of money.
All right, Peter Corbett, final question.
Yeah.
I'm going to throw myself under the bus.
Sure.
Somewhat on this, because you're an entrepreneur, very successful, mm-hmm. and we have a room full of entrepreneurs that are very successful mm-hmm. as well here on the island. And I'm a bit of a hybrid, so I'm not going to quit my day job tomorrow, I promise. But I'm one of those people where I dream that one day I can wake up and make my own time, put 1,000% into passion, you know? For people like me that are thinking about taking that step, that ultimate risk, you're standing on the edge of the cliff, your toes are off, push me off. What should the mindset be going into full-fledged entrepreneur?
So after you've taken the leap or not before?
Well, I want you to kick me off.
Listen, getting fired was, I was kicked off.
Yeah.
Right? I always knew that I wanted to be an entrepreneur. I always done entrepreneurial things, but I had never created a substantial company. And I didn't want to end up someone that never took a shot at it. So I set a deadline for myself. And this is what I encourage you to do. I said, listen, no matter what I'm doing, at the age 30, I'm going to quit my job and I'm going to do my own business. I don't care if it's selling hot dogs at, you know, on the National Mall in Washington, D.C., where I was at the time, or selling baseball hats at a baseball game. Like, I'm going to own the hot dog cart. I'm going to own the, you know, the hat cart. I got pushed out of the nest 3 years early. So I felt, for those 3 years, I felt like I was ahead. Right, which is a really kind of important little emotion to have when times are tough. So after, you know, a year or two, I was like, you know, is this going so well? I'm like, oh, it doesn't matter. Like, I'm already ahead, right? Which is like a crazy mental thing to say to yourself. But you need those crazy little mental things when you're an entrepreneur building something from nothing. So I encourage you to set a deadline. If you actually want to do this, tell yourself by age 40, no matter what I'm doing, I'm going to quit my job and I'm going to do my own thing. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, like, the years slip by. And then, like, the mortgage payment is different. And then there's another kid in the mix or one for the first time. And all of a sudden, there's all sorts of reasons not to. Mm-hmm. So I think a forced ejection from the nest, but I got fired. I was lucky, I guess, which is weird to say. Or you come up on your milestone and you go, oh, I have now quit. It's not even a decision. It is that birthday, I'm done.
Cool. All right, we'll leave it right there. Thanks again, Peter Corbett, founder and CEO of iStrategy Labs. We're going to have to do a part two of this. And
all
thank
right.
you to the BEDC, Jamila and Company, and also our room full of young entrepreneurs who have huge dreams and they're going to go places. And hopefully, the people online included watching this, we've just got a wealth of information.
Very
so
good.
Thank you very
thank
much.
You.
And we'll see you back
appreciate
in Bermuda
all right.
sometime soon.
Bye, Internet.